I'm Dr. April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, and your host for a new interview series, Talking Arts and Sciences. Over the course of this series, you will hear the candid and unscripted insights of experts involved in arts and sciences programs and activities that allow University of the District of Columbia graduates to aspire, accomplish, and take on the world. You will meet people who think creatively and critically. We will explore the full spectrum of education, of liberal education, and how it is applied in our contemporary world. This episode focuses on STEM, the acronym for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Mathematics, and the Verizon Corporation's Minority Male Makers Program at the University of the District of Columbia. This is a first of its kind technology program in the district designed for minority middle school boys. They will receive mentoring and on-hand experience across the STEM disciplines. Joining me to talk more about the program, its mission, and what participants can expect are Mr. Anthony Lewis, the Vice President of Verizon's Mid-Atlantic region, and Dr. James Maiden, Assistant Dean for Students in the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. Dr. Maiden is also the principal investigator for the grant funded by the Verizon Corporation. Welcome, Mr. Lewis.
Thank you.
Dr. Maiden.
Thank you.
I want to open this conversation by remarking on the comment of one of your Baltimore participants, Antoine Richardson. His enthusiasm, I think, is the spark that we often see in very young people that somehow gets lost between middle school and entry into college. And he talked about, he actually created an app that allows you, with a mentor, he created an app that allows you to enter a food that you like. And the app will actually spit out a recipe for doing it, making it in a healthier way. And he talked about almost like a light bulb moment for him, just how cool it was to see something that he thought about turned into something that impacts people in ways that he never could have imagined. And so when I think about arts and sciences, a College of Arts and Sciences, and its responsibility across the STEM imperative, there are three pieces. And I think Mr. Richardson made me, it really crystallized watching him, all three of those pieces. I think that nationally, we're focused on STEM from a perspective of building people toward careers because of the competitive edge that the U.S. needs to maintain internationally. And that's one part of it. But in arts and sciences college, while we have STEM disciplines, we also have responsibility for that broad base of skills that lets STEM students move beyond just having deep discipline knowledge, but we couch that in some soft skills and other types of intelligence that allow them to take those skills to careers that can be launched and sustained. In addition to that, arts and sciences colleges also have responsibility for really looking at STEM education for all and really helping to create a fabric really across the U.S. for embedding resources that incubate that natural level of inquiry that we all come into this world with, and growing that so that if we choose to be in STEM careers, we have the base for that. But if we don't make that choice, we have a science base that allows us to successfully navigate lives. And so I think about when you watch parents of new children, new parents of young children, and seeing them at the beach and watching kids let sand fall through their fingers. That's a science moment.
Exactly.
The first time a kid scrapes his or her knee and the blood comes and then the scab forms. A science moment.
Yes.
So kids are naturally in that place of being inquisitive. But what happens that we don't incubate that over time and kind of ignite the science geek that lurks inside of all of us and helps us successfully navigate things like knowing that the Memorial Bridge with all of the infrastructure issues that have been posted in the news is or isn't safe to travel. Understanding that the metro system in DC with, you know, things blowing up, catching on fire, smoke-filled cars, is or isn't safe. Knowing that we need a level of Fios or not for our homes versus what we need for our business. So every one of us needs to be a scientist all day, every day. And so I think that the Minority Mail Makers Program is an important segue for the University of the District of Columbia to move beyond the discussion of pipeline building toward careers and looking at informing citizens across the world in a way that helps level the playing field of people who understand the blood work that comes back from the lab and knowing that their numbers are either in a healthy place or they're not, and knowing how that helps them formulate the questions to the doctor, for knowing that when you see on YouTube a video about the corrosive effects of some sodas, that you make a good choice about whether or not you ingest that. And so I want to talk very specifically about the Verizon program nationally and what this program at UDC means for the District of Columbia. But I also want to talk about just science in a broader way and the role that Verizon is playing in helping the nation achieve some of the benchmarks that have been set for it, maybe not by us initially, but by what's going on in other parts of the world. So Mr. Lewis, I want to start with you because people might look at you and see a businessman, but you're a scientist because you couldn't navigate the world for Verizon if you weren't always in a mindset of problem solving, which is what a scientist does. So can you tell the audience a little bit about who you are in terms of background and education and interest?
I'd love to, and first of all, thank you so very much for the opportunity to be here at this marvelous university in your department. I wanna thank President Mason for the partnership that we have embarked on. This is historic for Verizon, and I say that specifically, and we'll talk more about that. But this is not simply a program. It is, in fact, the opportunity to build an ecosystem. And so I do want to make sure we have an opportunity to discuss all the realms. And I'm so happy that you said, not only me, but we're all scientists in our daily lives. So a bit about my background. I have 29 years at the Verizon Corporation. I started out as a first-level manager in something called operator services. Now, many of your guests may not remember that you used to dial 411 and zero to get information that you now get on your smartphones. But that's where I started and I progressed through the corporation and have had just a wonderful opportunity to serve our customers each and every day. So I'm very proud of that. I've had a wonderful team of folks around me through every step of my career path, and I'm very happy to be here living in the District of Columbia, leading the region that includes Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland, Virginia, the District of Columbia. And so we cover all the public policy issues as well as the foundation issues. So okay. it's a pleasure to be here as a resident as well as a leader in the Verizon Corporation on behalf of all of our employees to implement these types of programs. And I must say that we can't do this without our customers. The folks out there who believe in this company and trust in us to serve them, and that is a trust these days because it's not just a phone call, it's information that you're using. The science that you're using evolves from those smartphones, those smart programs that are in your home and in your office that allow us to be here. So it's our customers that give me the opportunity to serve you, and I thank them for that.
So tell us a bit about you in terms of your educational preparation and what things in early life sparked your interest and led you to this place.
Well, I'd love to tell this story because I am a farm boy. I grew up in Southern Virginia, literally on a working farm. My grandfather never set foot in a schoolroom. He was a farmer from the time he was able to pick up a crop or a hoe. I was able to live with my grandparents in my early childhood. And one of the first lessons I learned that I carry with me every day is you get up and go to work every day so that you can eat. It doesn't magically happen. We farmed. We grew vegetables. We had animals on the farm. My grandmother gardened and picked the food that we were going to eat from that garden every day and cooked it. And so the lesson that I didn't realize I was learning, but I did, was you get up every day, go to work, and then you're able to, quote, enjoy life. You're able to get the things from life that you need. It's a very simple lesson, but very powerful for me because I've been able to translate that into every aspect of any job I've held, inside or outside Verizon. First and foremost, it's do you care enough about you and your surroundings to give your very best every day? And back in those days, it was so you could sustain yourself. In today's terms, it is, are you doing what is expected of you by your employer? And more importantly, what your customers expect from you. When you get up every day thinking about the customer, focused on their needs, you will do well. You really will. I was lucky enough to have a family base that instilled that inside me from day one. Before I knew I was learning those lessons, they were being embedded in my mind. So I'm blessed that I had that kind of opportunity to grow up in an environment where I could put my hands in the dirt, grow something, back to your scientist quote, and see how things worked, how the soil worked, how when it wasn't raining, my grandfather was not happy. When it did rain, he was. How we had seasonal work. And of course, every Sunday we got up and went to church for that part of the spiritual foundation that I think is important in life.
Very nice. So the impetus for minority mail makers.
So we have had a history of providing all types of foundational opportunities in this great city and around my region. And I'm very proud of what we've done over my entire career. But I love what's happening now because we have had the opportunity to really focus on needs in many different aspects. But this need, and specifically, the need of young minority males, given where we're going. And again, you said it best in your opening. When you think about what's happening today, and it's always happened, we just didn't see it as much as we do now. You need a level of intellect in order to live in a manner that's going to allow you to sustain your family, grow intellectually, and really make a difference in your society. And you do that when you are aware of all the things that you're capable of. When society allows you, if you don't have a two-parent family, if you don't have a family at all, if you're with relatives, if you're with friends, gives you an opportunity, despite that, to learn and grow. And so when we looked around at the kinds of opportunities that were available, we saw a gap. We saw this gap that said, we recognize that these young men need an opportunity, but we don't see action being taken. And so we said, let's take action. And most important to me, it was, Verizon's not trying to solve the problem itself. We know there are schools like this marvelous university who have the scope, the scale, the personnel, and the local ties that can reach out to these young men to make sure that, again, this is not a program, this is not a flash, this is an ecosystem of learning opportunity that we're going to start and lean on the entire community to say, we're gonna give these young men the opportunity they deserve. We're gonna give them the tools they need to succeed. All we need to do is participate and watch them learn and grow. I'm so glad you pointed out Mr. Richardson and his wonderful story from the opportunities we've had in the Baltimore area. When you see these young men initially on their first and second day and the opportunity to create something, which is why we call it minority male maker, we want them to understand that they can create, they can make, and the tools, luckily now, technology has evolved, that we can show them how to very quickly get into the aspect of making things and then watch them take off. It is marvelous to see their minds literally burning with opportunity. There's another story I'd like to mention, if you don't mind, of a young man, and I'm so proud of him. When we talked to him about what they really wanted to make and why, this young man said that his sister really needed some type of device to keep her from dropping her phone. She would plug her phone into the wall, it'd be on the floor, people would kick it around, and he was worried about his family, which I loved. He created a device that would allow the phone to sit off the floor so that she could plug it in, people wouldn't bump into it. A very simple concept, but those are the kind of things that sell. Those are the kind of things that you and I go to the store and say, I wish I had X. Middle schooler, just wanting to solve a problem. This is how great things are invented. If we give these young men a chance, they will do it. And so I'm so proud that we are able to do this in cooperation with the University of District of Columbia and find opportunities for these young men to do the things they really want to do.
Our next generation of shark tankers.
How about that?
I want to bring Dr. Maiden into the conversation. When the Verizon call went out for the DC region, President Mason sent it out and he said, I need somebody to do this. And I said, Dr. Maiden, I think it should be you. And he said, okay. And he went about the work of piecing together an amazing proposal, good amount of creativity and thought. And so, Dr. Maiden, can you talk about what you thought when you saw the proposal, I mean the call, the RFP initially, what you thought it could be on UDC's campus, and as things are now unfolding, you have funding.
Yes,
funding. Tell us what, where we stand with the project now, but what you want, and what you want long term.
Well, first of all, I would like to thank Verizon for giving us, for having this partnership with us. We've been very blessed to have you guys participate with us and joining with us to engage these young men into, to turn on that light bulb to inspire them to be within the STEM discipline. My background, as you know, is that I am a counselor education person, so therefore, I was a little intimidated by the whole STEM discipline, but as a counselor education, my passion has always been working with minority men. Mm-hmm. To inspire them to not only graduate from high school, to encourage them to be successful within college, and to push them to that graduate level of success as well. So when I saw this opportunity, I said, wow, we get a chance to reach out to middle school students. And these students are, they're at an age that they're impressionable, but they're at an age that it's easier for them to take this information, it's easier for them to pick up on this, and then and about that light bulb piece, it just comes on and you have that spark and they're engaged. So I'm excited about, I was just so excited that I was able to be able to reach out to this population. My vision for this program is not, it's a two-year program, but it doesn't stop there. We plan on tracking the students throughout their middle school years and throughout their college years, because we want to make sure that they are part of the UDC family, that we want to follow them, and we want to currently engage with them to make sure that they are doing the necessary things and that they're using the information that they've gained from this program. Part of what the program will encompass is a mentoring component. For minority males, it's so important that they have someone within the discipline to be there for them, to give them some more insight, to just keep in contact with them and to continue to inspire them. So that's a major component of this program. One of the things that a lot of parents are learning about now as we discuss this program is that we're offering free tutoring for these students. So these students who may, through their academic year, they need some assistance with math, they're able to come back to campus. They're able to call their mentor up and say, hey, you know, I need some of this information. Can you help me with this? So we're looking at the long-term success for these students. It's not just about the summer camp. It's not just about following them throughout the semester. It's about following them throughout their career.
And let me also acknowledge this young man did a wonderful job with, I had a chance to read all of the grant applications. And I was very impressed and did not know he wasn't from the STEM discipline. And so it's another opportunity that is derived when you create these partnerships. Sometimes you don't know the learning opportunities that exist until you really jump in there and take some actions and get shot. So congratulations on what you've already done. And we had a chance to talk before this program, and I'm really pleased at where we are and where we're going with all the ideas that are being presented that weren't a part of the program.
Absolutely.
That's exactly what we want. Right. What else can we do? Which directions can we take? How do we make this our own Verizon UDC program? Right. So congratulations.
Thank you.
And that was one of the things that Jay commented on, and I want to follow up with you also, Mr. Lewis. I think that middle school kids are, they're in that tipping place, and they can tip forward or back.
Correct.
And so while they're highly impressionable, and that's good in terms of furthering learning, They're also highly susceptible to all the vices of the world, mm-hmm. including one that we don't think about so much, but just becoming disinterested.
Yes. Correct.
Sometimes that's the most detrimental part of being an adolescent. Mm-hmm. You can just shut off. And when we look at the data across higher ed, it is in the middle school grades that kids slip away from the very subjects that will allow them to go any place that they want in terms of next steps. So, an important thing about this program is that it does what all of the science says makes sense for kids at this age. It turns the learning model on its head. So it's an upside down approach that makes the experiential part of learning the teacher. So it's not about having a lecture, then hands-on. Mm-hmm. It's about coupling the hands-on with lecture supports, but you're learning by doing. And I think that these young men have an amazing opportunity just to explore, and I think an important piece about the program and what Verizon intends for it to be, it's self-directed learning. You come in and you say what type of project you want to pursue. Mm-hmm. We're not telling you, you have to do A and B and C, and then you can get to D. Mm-hmm. You're saying to us, you know what, I always wanted to know about X or Y or Z. Can you help me get there? And I think that that's an important piece in terms of having them understand the power of their thought and having them understand that they have the ability to direct where they go. And that starts now. It doesn't start when you're 18 or 25 or 30. It starts now. And so I think it's a really important piece, but really quickly, we're going to run out of time soon. I want to talk about how we scale this so that every young man of color in the District of Columbia who, I'm not even going to say wants such an experience, but needs this experience, what's the work that we now do in this partnership to make sure that beyond this 100 men, young men, mm-hmm. that every person, young man of color, and eventually it's going to be young women of color.
Yes.
So where do we go in terms of next steps to take this thing to scale?
And so I try to keep life very simple, and that is, let's make this successful. Mm-hmm. You know, let's take this first 100 young men, mm-hmm. And make sure that we do everything we can to ensure that we see the kind of metrics that we want. And what I mean mm-hmm. by that is, they need to be excited about right. education, mm-hmm. excited about making, excited about creating, and saying to us, I need another class. I want to take this month and expand it to 2 months and expand it to 3 months. When you mm-hmm. see that kind of excitement, it's very simple to say, let's increase this twofold, fivefold, right. tenfold. And as you know, we are doing this around the country, and so we'd look to have over 1,000 young people involved in this mm-hmm. Over the next 2 years. And so the opportunity for scale is absolutely there. Okay. What we have to do is execute.
Absolutely.
And make sure these young people get exactly what they need. I'm fully confident if we give them a platform, mm-hmm. they will grow.
Okay. You have any thoughts on?
Yeah, and I would also like to add, one of the components that we added to our program here at UDC is the parental component,
absolutely.
Because it's very important that the students get the information, but you engage the parents. You let the parents know what the students are learning, because when they leave us, they go home. And so if they're going home and they're excited about what's going on and the parents have a sense of what's taking place, they keep encouraging their students as well. So mm-hmm. it's very important that we also have the parents come here. We have the parents here for an orientation, but we'll have parent events throughout the semester as well, where parents can come here to campus for those entrepreneurial workshops, because it's important that students not only know that they can do this, but okay, what kind of career I can have with this? Mm-hmm. You have students come to talk to me every day about, well, I'd like to do this, but is there a job for this? Can I actually do something
right.
with mm-hmm. this? So those entrepreneurial workshops that we will have, those college readiness workshops, and along with having that parental involvement is very important mm-hmm. and it's key.
If I may say, to your point, when you look at the workforce of the future, if you could capsulize it, it's really about being able to provide solutions. In the quote old days, it was more tactical. Can you mm-hmm. do A and B and equal C?
Mm-hmm.
Now and in the future, you need people who can provide you solutions to your problems.
Absolutely.
Those are knowledge workers. These are people who can think about a specific situation and solve a problem. Mm-hmm. These young men will be immersed in that space, solving problems. I couldn't be happier.
I agree. I think that it is an amazing opportunity for the partnership between Verizon and the University of the District of Columbia. But I think more importantly, and I was very pleased that Ms. Henderson was a part of the launch, because it really does become a partnership that engages Verizon, UDC, and the District of Columbia public and charter schools, because that's the pipeline exactly. that's building into this. And so I was very pleased that she was present and very supportive.
Absolutely.
So I want to thank you both. Mr. Lewis, I know you're a very busy person, so that you took the time to be here, it speaks to the importance of the Male Makers Program for Verizon, so thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
I want to thank you for the funding. Dr. Maiden, I want to thank you for the way that you've taken this bull by the horns and just run with it, and you have created on this campus an opportunity that was missing in this city. And so I'm excited to see what the summer brings. I'm more excited to see what students look like over the course of the year. I want to see them bounding up on this campus after school, happy to be here, excited, able to mix with minority men who are already in college, and just seeing that provides a mentoring opportunity. So I just want to say thank you. So if you would like to have more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia College of Arts and Sciences, please visit us at www.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at UDC. Our hashtag is Your Dream, Our Guidance.